the Beaver County Board of Commissioners work session for Wednesday, September 26, 2018. I'd first like to thank Monaca Borough for accommodating the Board of Commissioners of Beaver County, Borough Manager Mario Leone, Mayor Simon Short, and all the council members, especially Councilman Derek Wilson. I see here, he was at our meeting, but he relayed the message and asked if we could host the meeting here, so thank you again for having us. Review of work session discussion meeting minutes. I have no changes or no questions.
I made two changes. There was a space change and then a double word was taken out.
Okay.
So that was all I have.
We will move to Department Head Reports. Dan Colville, Department of Public Works.
Good morning. I just have a couple updates for you folks. I reported to you a few weeks back about the courthouse roof has several leaks in it. I have finally secured the third bid. They have came in, they've come in pretty equal, and I will be meeting with, I'd like to schedule an appointment to meet with Garen and Nate to move forward with that. Also, the boat dock repairs, we did get the approval, the purchase order placed and returned to me. I have ordered those. We are scheduled to go pick those up probably Friday. And I did talk with Mario Leone, Borough Manager here at Monaca, and got permission. I worked with the EMA team, UBAR, see if they can get their boat to tow the docks over here. They gave us permission to repair them and fix them here over a couple day period at their boat launch. I reached out to John Hudson, once again, our forester. Left him a voicemail that if I didn't hear from him soon, that we were going to be forced to move forward. It's amazing how that tends to get someone to return a phone call. He did have some health issues, and also he told me that the industry has hit a dip because of the tariffs and things like that. Almost the winter it goes over to China. So the industry did take a dip. They're anticipating that makes a return in about 5 to 6 months. So, I told him as soon as he hears something, please contact us. We want to continue to move forward with the timber. We have a couple service agreements that need to be renewed. One's Damon Industries. they take care of the chemicals for our water softeners, which in return, the water softeners take care of the cooling towers, the heating loops, things of that nature for our heating and air conditioning. I'll be also reaching out to the law department to let them go over that service agreement. Also, the one with firefighters, it's an annual thing that is also ready to have them looked at and hopefully renew that. Some things that came up since last meeting. Tim and I are working. He has a problem with a sewer line at the ice arena. It's one that we've had some issues with in the past. Our guys have gone in and tried to jet it, snake it. We've had a company come in and try to jet it to no success. We were able to get it open, but unfortunately, now that Tim's back opened up and there's more use there, it's backing up on a daily basis. We had it open again yesterday, and Tim told me that it's back up again this morning. So we had a contractor come in and televise that line yesterday. It is crushed and collapsed. And I'm waiting. I told them that if they could do me a favor, give me the quote. I told them we were meeting here today at 10 o'clock. They're working on it. I asked them to just shoot from the hip. I couldn't hold it to them. He said it should come in under $5,000. And there's sewage in that locker room. So I would hope that we can handle that under an emergency situation, get that taken care of.
Yeah, that's definitely an emergency.
How long is the line?
Maybe 5 feet.
Yeah. We're fortunate that it is outside the building as well. That way we don't have to go in there and bust up the floor, dig up tile, everything like that. So.
Are you going to only replace the pipe, the portion that is crushed?
I haven't got a chance to look at the film yet, but if the other pipe is in good shape,
yeah,
you're talking a major price difference there, going inside of the building, digging up the floor and everything like that. If the rest of the pipe is in good shape and we can do a good tie into it, we'll be okay with that.
Did they say what it's made out of?
It's terracotta. That's all I have.
Any other questions for Dan? This room familiar to you?
Very familiar, yeah. I'm just the Indian though.
I'm sorry, Dan, one more question. The timber, it's already down.
Yeah, that phase one is done. We've already received the check, everything like that. We're looking to move forward on phase two at Brush Creek Park.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Dan? Tim Mishman, Parks and Recreation.
Good morning. Tim Mishman, Director of Recreation and Tourism. Dan, some updates. It's on the ice arena in addition to what Dan shared with you. On the sharpener, his mechanic, Mark
Garen,
has come over at the skate sharpener. He's taken the motor off. We're having it retooled, the shaft on that side of it, and there was a belt replacement, so I think the cost is to get this machine up and running for way less than what we got back to snuff again. So we're pursuing that particular option. And I think before the month's out, we should be pretty close to having that back.
Is that the only problem with it?
There was a belt that was kind of stretched. We put the belt on, got a little spinning again, and they said the shaft was wobbly, so they got to put a bolt on it, retool it, and then when they bring it back in again, they expect it to work perfect.
But was there a pull on the motor? Are the blades still good?
The stones? So we replace stones on a regular basis, probably two or three times a year, because they wear down as you sharpen, so they have to be replaced on a regular basis. There's about 120 to 150 cuts, depending on the hollow that they're doing or how long you get out of a stone. So they vary, but they're $30 a piece. We typically get about $300 worth of stones a year.
We had a discussion a couple months ago about the pros and cons of new versus fixing. And one of the things that stuck with me was that this sharpener that we have is old technology. Mm-hmm. And when you're sharpening those blades, you don't have a gauge. So it's kind of like you're sharpening blind. Is there anything, or is that you'd have to just get the new technology?
No, we have a tool for $250, which is a blade leveler, which we're looking at right now in regards to putting that in as a request to do that. That, when you set it on, basically it's a level and it shows you one side of the blade's thicker or thinner.
Yeah.
And basically you look down through this apparatus and it gives you that and you can go in and take it off again. The new tech that we were talking about.
Yes.
The unit itself is fairly inexpensive, about $3,000. But because there's 11 different hollows, depending on what the skater's looking for, you have to buy a stone for each hollow, and they're $50 to $60 a stone, and they get about 50 cuts out of them. So the back end costs are astronomical. So this is probably still the better tech, you know, to go with to get the machine up to speed, low cost, get another tool to aid in regards to quality cuts,
mm-hmm.
and I think we'll be in pretty good shape there.
It just concerned me because you have all new skates down there.
Mm-hmm.
So
why the $250 tool makes a lot
yes,
of sense in
yes.
regards to doing what we need
thank
to do.
You.
It's an inexpensive way of attacking.
Okay, thank you.
So that takes care of that. We talked last week about this air pump for cooling the air in the ice arena. I've been talking with Reno back and forth. Back in the 90s, early 2000s, when the tennis facility was put in, there's two huge air handler fans above the observation deck. That really, where the intent was, from what I'm told, was to bring the cooler air from the ice arena over to the tennis court, cool it off. Well, after 5 minutes, I guess it rained pretty good, and they realized that wasn't the best idea to do. So there's this new equipment that's up there that really hasn't been used in decades, that potentially asked Reno to, if it were a viable option, about potentially running ductwork from that through the roof and actually pulling the air out. And seeing if that's not another option in regards to just simply trying to modify cooler air in there and look at another potential way of addressing the humidity issue. So I'm exploring that right now. I just want to let you know it's an option we're pursuing on that side of it. Let's see here. Live barn, which you approved a resolution for, pursuing that particular project because of the internet connection that we lack. Really strong internet facilities in regards to the ice arena, we'd be forced to go to fiber optic, and what used to be something in Live Barn they would pay for now is going to be a shared cost. So I'm wrestling with the cost that we would have to pick up versus the revenues that are generated for the value of doing it. So that project's still kind of stewing at this point in time. As I work with Kevin and IT and looking at some other ways of maybe possibly attacking this. But the initial, the typical, prototypical approach of this is not something that we're afforded based on our location and our limited Wi-Fi. So that's a challenge right there on that. I want to give you an update on that. Let's see here. The barn bash is pretty much ready to go. Just got to pick up some hay. Yeah, that's all the advertising's out. You know, things are going to start getting over the next couple of weeks. So that's October 13th up at Old Comedy Park Barn. Again, you'll start seeing more of that on social media and on the different platforms in which we advertise. We'll use some of our spots from BBP to advertise that as well, too. Again, it'll be our last event there for the season. So just that's a quick update on that. Smoking policy, jumping into a policy matter. In regards to a couple weeks ago, I brought up dumb lungs as a request of putting signage around our playgrounds. I forwarded that to the legal department. Basically, if there's a desire to do so, then we would move forward in amending the existing ordinance policy that we have to wrap that in. And again, if that's a desire of the board to pursue, just need direction to do so and bring that up. On top of that, I'd also, as chair of the safety committee, this has been talked about a number of times, but we'd like to have a set of meeting to discuss and evaluate the current policy and see if it's not worthy of reconsideration, dedicating rather than totally restricting, but setting a dedicated smoking area, maybe in one of the inner courtyards, where it would work from a better, improve a safety scenario that we currently have been battling for a long time. We know that there's no benefit in regards to reducing our healthcare rates. It would give us a dedicated location inside the building, which would make it easier for multiple departments to, from the court side to the sheriff's side, would start to hopefully eliminate or minimize staff going out emergency doors to smoke, things along those lines. If we had a dedicated spot inside, we could control it a lot better. And having a dedicated space is not something that's unheard of. The pendulum swung far left in regards to the total banishment. Maybe now that makes it a little bit more sense to consider a dedicated area because people's habits are going to be their habits. But if we restrict where that might be, you see it in airports, bus stations, all over the place. Just something to kind of request a meeting to talk about again, maybe revisit as a county. So if we're going to review the amendment or the ordinance for young lungs, maybe it's a time now to take a look at that as well, to kill two birds with one stone along those lines. Let's see, is there anything else I need to touch base with you? That's all I got.
Any questions for Tim? There we now move to any other department heads would like to report anything or speak. Seeing none, move on to the solicitor's report.
Last week, Commissioner Camp, you wanted the law department and the HR department to look into a policy regarding volunteer firefighters that have called out to catastrophic events. We're in the process of putting together a policy that we should have to you guys next week in order for you to sort of look at the draft view of that. The basis of it is that currently we don't have a policy in place, so any volunteer firefighter who's a county employee that would get called to a event, they have to use vacation time or personal time in order to go to that event. And this would look to try to enable them to go there without using any type of vacation or personal time to any of those events. So we should have a draft version next week for you guys to review. Moving on to the list of resolutions for tomorrow. 17 through 20 are all exonerations. 20, I will point out, is a little bit different. This is for approximately 38 tax parcels in the city of Aliquippa. This is being done through a grant, I believe it's through the state, project through the state. Number 22 is the contract for Babs Collins regarding Special Labor Council. Number 29 is through EMS. This is a study to look at it before a proposed radio tower in Big Beaver to hopefully get better service in that area. Number 30 is just with the Sheriff's Department. The Sheriff brought this in front of you a couple weeks ago. It's for copier, scan, faxes, machines in his office. And then 31 and 32, a little bit of, they're the exact same thing, but 31 rescinds the previous ordinance. There was, the numbers were correct in that previous ordinance that you passed. Number 32 is the new one that has the correct numbers, and this has to do with housing here in the mental health department. So those will all be listed on the agenda for you guys tomorrow. And then the only other thing that we do have is a request for an executive session in order to discuss a real estate matter.
Any questions or discussions on the resolutions for tomorrow's meeting?
Just for conversation's sake, because I usually vote no on assessment cases, I will be voting yes on the number 20 because that is a project opposed to individuals. And that is a project that goes through CED and it's addressing blight in the entire in the community. So that project, I feel, is a different entity than the others. And I will be voting no on 22, the Babs Callan, and all the other ones I'm completely fine with.
Yeah, just as Commissioner Ailey said, number 20 is a grant with Pennsylvania Economic Development, and it's tied in with
BNY
Mellon Bank, correct? They're matching some monies for out of public to pursue this project. So
all those transfers will be used.
Questions on any of the resolutions that are proposed for tomorrow's meeting? Hearing none. Board of Commissioners reports. First, I would just, I don't know if we want to talk about any other business or the report, the Watsonville Bridge. I know we have folks here to discuss it. They're on a tight time frame, I believe. Not for the meeting, but to get the decision. The solicitor office did get the answer, and Cindy, I think, got the answer from our insurance company of how much it was going to cost to insure it per year.
$200 per year.
The maintenance is very little, correct, Dan?
Very little.
And the inspection, we have everyone here. The inspection does not need to be done on a yearly.
Correct.
Would that be at our, how often we want to have it done?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a pedestrian, correct? Is that why?
Yes.
So there's no inspection needed, so the cost is very minimal. So I just want to see if the board would like to discuss this and move forward and putting a motion on the agenda for tomorrow that will be set today at lunchtime on whether or not the county is going to accept the Watsonville Bridge. Is that the correct terminology?
Yeah, essentially what we've been asked to do is there's a memorandum of understanding that would have to be put together that ultimately, once the restoration is done on the bridge, that's going to be done by PennDOT, that it would be turned over to the county for the county's responsibility to move forward. We want a memorandum of understanding that would be that way everyone understands what their responsibilities are moving forward with it.
Yeah, I'd be in favor of putting it on the agenda.
We did check with both municipalities on each side. They were in charge of the roads leading up to it, correct?
They are, and I did reach out. It's Darlington on one side and South Beaver on the other. And the wheels have sort of been put in motion by both of those communities to accept those roads. They're sort of waiting to see what ultimately happens with the bridge itself. But they are on board with
it. Again, I'm in favor of putting it in the
general. I was a little more on the fence about this on the bridge because it is a historical place and it's preserving something from the past. And I have some feelings of that we should preserve our older bridges, but at the same time we're adding to what we already have that we can't afford. So I'm struggling with that, but I think that both of you are voting to pass that.
Let me put it this way. I got a nice letter from my 10th grade English teacher who's about 85 years old, asking me to please support the bridge. So I was already supporting the bridge before I got the letter, but in their honor, especially the
bridge. So I think I would be in favor of putting it on for asking for a motion tomorrow. I do support it, I think, just because of the minimum cost that we're going to have. Dan, is this something that your crew has to do because we're going to be using more machinery, or is there something that we can send the inmates out to?
No, this is something that we would be able to handle.
Use a bigger machinery.
Something's going to be coming across your desk very, very soon. for a piece of the equipment that can be used at all these locations. So that would blend in right with this.
You'll cross that bridge when you.
Exactly.
The only other thing I have is to discuss the interview process and the interviews for the Children's Youth Service. I don't know if anyone has anything before we want to talk about that, but like be a little bit smaller.
The only thing I had was the bridge.
Okay.
We received the media packet from PACER for press releases, and it analyzed our social media and that type of thing. Since I'm bringing it up now, maybe we can discuss it next week after we all review it. Is that okay?
Yeah, can we put that on the agenda for next week?
Okay.
You know, under commissioner reports or department has a review of the media. Moving on to Children and Youth Services. Last week we discussed briefly the interview process that took place the Monday before. We put a RFQ, I guess, request for qualifications / job description out for Children and Youth Services solicitor. We had a solicitor who is not there anymore, and they are working on an interim basis right now. There were 7 candidates. There were 3 that were interviewed. After the interview process, as we discussed last week, we believe, and I think HR could speak of as well, that there might be more work than one solicitor could handle for our Children's Youth Services. That's just, you know, our opinion. I think our director of Children's Youth Services said it doesn't matter if we have 1, 2, 3, or 4. She has a budget she has to stay within. And this will be a contracted employee. Is that the right term? Contract is going to be not employee. I don't want to use the term employee. But they will not be collecting county benefits or county pension. So the 3 that were interviewed were Rob Alsko, Dana Quitas, and Joe Askar. So I would like to ask the board if we can make a decision on would we want to accept 1 solicitor, 2 solicitors, 3 solicitors for this position. And secondly, the question that was brought up last week, when the contract is done, is there going to be something looked at in there to say the board will say who, if they can't do the work, who they can sub it out to, or do they get to choose? I think that's
Historically, this position has been an independent contractor. The contracts have been silent regarding if the individual or individuals who are appointed, if they would be permitted, if they can't do it, to essentially subcontract it out to someone else. That is probably something that should be addressed in the new contract that we would have with the independent contractor.
Is that something, I guess another question might be also is, I don't necessarily know if these 3 candidates, I guess maybe are gonna be aware of what our decision is gonna be. Once, if we decide to have 2, if we decide to have 1 or 3, do we need to go back to them and say, this switched, you know, maybe they're not interested if it's not, before we make our decision on who we're gonna appoint and put in this position.
Yeah, because ultimately there's gonna be a contract that's gonna be signed between the county and the individual, and they're not obligated to take, to accept what the county's offer is.
Okay.
And is one going to be the chief solicitor, and then you have?
I don't believe so.
Or is it going to be
that's just my opinion. I think that was discussed briefly last week, and you wouldn't recommend him making 1 a chief because the department's going to delegate the casework, correct? I mean that's what my understanding was. If we decide to go that route,
yeah, I think we come from the department head. They would direct what work to be done and do.
Yeah, because I don't think
that's how it works now, isn't it?
Yeah, well, it works now, but it would work just as that one independent contractor was directing who to
because
do,
the 3 candidates that we have work experience. They've done this, so apparently this work was delegated to them throughout the years.
I have no problem going to 2. I think that with your advice that you realized during the interview process that this is a lot more than we anticipated. So So I did my due diligence and I called other counties, and they do have several CYS solicitors. And I wanted to be sure that the decision that I was making was accurate. So I feel very comfortable in that. However, I do believe that the solicitors that we hire have to do the work. This subbing out and contracting out, I don't believe is the right way to go, because we haven't vetted those people. We've vetted these. And that's where I wouldn't waver on that.
Well, if we hire more than one, there wouldn't be a need for them to look elsewhere.
I think it should be addressed in the contract that the solicitors that we hire have to do the work. They don't subcontract that out.
I would agree.
I agree too.
So I think the first question is answered. We agreed to put on the agenda for tomorrow, because she's on a tight time frame, just like the Watts Mill. Two separate motions, Garen, correct? And you could work with Tony. I'm assuming the contract the county or the state has approved for Children Youth Services is $150,000. So I would assume we're going to separate that, bring half of $75,000 for each one.
And that's the cap.
They may not get up there. Yeah, it was always 150. I think the last 3 years it hasn't been above 105, 110. So they may not get there. So the motion would potentially read a motion to appoint a children's youth solicitor at $100 an hour, do not exceed $75,000.
And it's going to be kind of up in the air right now, because they don't know this.
Yes.
They're thinking they're applying for a $150,000 job.
Which they are. I mean, they think they are. So that is my question.
That'll give them more time to work on the rest of the practice. You know, if they don't have this, we have full-time solicitors that work entirely for us, and we have part-time solicitors that work half and half or three quarters of a quarter. So I think it's probably good for both of them, or all three of them, or whichever way we decide to go.
So on the agenda tomorrow, there'll be two separate motions, Karen.
Mm-hmm. If you're going to appoint two people, we're going to have two separate motions.
Can you reach out to the three candidates after the meeting today, or HR, and see if obviously they're still interested? And I guess we could make a motion to appoint or put someone in that position, but they don't ultimately have to.
Yeah, we'll reach out to HR just to make sure, to tell them, hey, this is what's going to be on the agenda. And then obviously, if anyone aren't interested in that, we'll let you guys know.
Moving on to the candidates, two of the three already have current contracts with the county, so they might weigh their options on which.
Yeah, because ultimately, if they're appointed to this position, they're not going to be able to have that other position.
And two of them are within CYS, and one has more than one contract, which is in other departments in the county. So they're going to have to go, like you said, weigh their options on seeing which route they want to take their professional.
I think that's the best reason for picking two, because it gives them more money and they can get rid of their other contracts.
Okay. Any other questions or discussions on the Children Youth Services? I'm gonna ask for a motion. We could discuss today, but I don't think it would be wise to decide today. Garen, is that because if we decide today?
Well,
we gotta find out who wants to take it.
Yeah, I mean, certainly, the first thing we need to figure out is, do these three candidates want it under the circumstances? Because I don't believe, whenever the interviews were done, the discussion was brought up that it might be
two.
You know, not the 150 with one person. And hopefully we can reach out to them this afternoon and get an answer on that.
And you would get back to us on that?
Yeah, I mean, if someone says that under those circumstances they don't want to be considered, we'll let you guys know.
Why wouldn't we pick the two and narrow it down to those two?
still, I mean, if we pick two and then one doesn't want it, then we didn't pick the other one, they might want it. That's the only.
Okay.
I that would just be my opinion. So I'm requesting Garen to coordinate or HR, they can work together to reach out to these candidates, ask who would want it, if the rate has changed, and then get back to us. And then tomorrow, we'll ask for motions in a second, and then discuss it again.
Okay, it'll be a place where we can discuss. Okay.
Any other questions or any other reports from the board?
I have a item for executive session. It's an employee matter.
All right, Board of Commissioners, budget report. Cordy, I believe, has been working with our office. All the budgets are in. I believe he plans on coming down next week for a few days to start the meeting process. Any other business anyone would like to discuss? Audience participation.
I have a couple things. Number one, if I can ask Dan Colbo, do we have an estimate on how much we were hoping to generate on phase two of the timber?
Phase one came in, I think we got $53,000 or $56,000. So we're hoping to get somewhere in that ballpark.
Is it about the same land size?
It's about the same.
Part? Okay.
Yes.
But it's the trees that exist.
It's the site. Yes, it's the different trees.
Sometimes,
okay.
And like you mentioned China, I remember we had a big sale once with walnut, black walnut, because the Japanese were buying it. So we were able to do well. It all depends on what the market is.
And to follow up with that real quick, the reason why this isn't being done is because of tariff issues. So you're literally saying that Donald Trump's trade war is preventing us from.
He's not saying that.
No, I'm not saying that.
He's not saying that.
That's what I was saying. Is that what the forester is
that's
saying?
What, yeah. The price, the lumber, they're shipped over to China, and from what he's telling me is it caused a dip in the economy. It caused a dip in the industry.
So our forester saying that Donald Trump's trade war is stopping us from foresting Brush Creek.
That's what he said, not me.
I just want to be sure I was clear about that. I appreciate that. Second issue is with the smoking policy and the issue of employees exiting emergency exits to smoke. I remember the board went through I think it started under Amadeo's leadership on the prior board, an issue of passcode keys and who could get in and out of the building with bypassing security, and it was taken very seriously. I know it's still an issue that's taken seriously, and it sounds like this issue of smoking is bypassing all of that work that was put through on who should be able to bypass the security procedures of the courthouse. Has any employee been disciplined for violating security policies by using those doors in an unauthorized fashion without naming individuals that have? Is that something that the county has been doing?
I think the answer to that question is no. I think the emergency doors, people can use those. I think the issue is the access, who has the key. So what I think is going on, people are going out those emergency doors to smoke. Going back around the front through security to go back in, I think is what it is.
So they're not like propped out the emergency exits?
My understanding, no.
So just to touch base on that, Tim, there is a committee made up of the courts, the sheriffs, and one other representative, I believe, to go over the emergency exit doors. Maybe Kevin Tussick and IT. Mm-hmm. They are working on something to stop having employees use the emergency exits during the day.
You've seen those bars.
Right.
That's something I believe the safety committee, they're working on, correct?
That committee that you referenced brought it to the safety committee.
Okay.
The reason that I said, yeah, there's a smaller group that deals with other issues outside of that. That's just something that's brought up.
Okay.
So you're talking about like having alarms on the bars then when you push them and
get embarrassed?
Yeah, there's some kind of like a chirper.
Okay. The Aliquippa parcels, is that approved by Aliquippa first and then approved by the county? Do you know that process as far as forgiveness on those taxes?
Yeah, it goes to the city and the school district first, and then once those are exonerated, then it comes up here.
So in theory then Aliquippa council should have already voted to exonerate those before it came to you?
I'm not sure it's the city of Aliquippa. It's the Aliquippa Economic Development
But there would be taxes owed to the city that would have to be exonerated as well, correct?
As a general matter, and I haven't looked into this, as a general matter, the exonerations aren't given to the commissioners for approval until they've been exonerated by the municipality and the school district.
So in theory, if minutes from the Aliquippa city council meetings would show that they've taken no action, and this board does take action, what are the ramifications of that?
There's no ramifications.
Okay.
In theory,
we can the county can exonerate the taxes without the municipality.
Okay, that's what I was asking. Final question I have is related to CYS solicitorship. There's a concern that the three finalists, the terms in which they applied have changed, and now the conditions under which they'd be working would be different, both in time dedication and in turn compensation they'd be getting. Is there any concern that you're not picking a finalist and that the original RFQ that went out didn't convey what the final contracts will be? In other words, is there a possibility that people didn't apply because they thought that the time constraints would be too large for them, and if they had known that that time dedication would be less, maybe they would have applied? Is there an issue with the county having changed the terms of that contract after the initial RFQ went out?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's speculative. Obviously, we can't know what people would or wouldn't have done based on knowing what the job would entail. I don't know how to answer that for other people.
Is there ramifications in the fact that the county changed those contracts after the RFQ went out?
No.
And I noticed the board hasn't talked about the bona fides or concerns related to any of the individual service vendors. Is the board intending that not to do that until after a motion is made to literally hire one of them, contract with one of them? Is that the procedure that's going to be happening?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
So in other words, the board has not discussed any of these individuals. So is there going to be a motion to contract one of them before there's a discussion as to their bona fides or concerns?
No, I think tomorrow, there will be a motion in a second, there will be a discussion on the floor.
So the bona fides or concerns for these vendors won't be discussed until after there's a motion on the floor to contract one of them?
No, that's what I asked Dan, is that we're going to have, and he said yes, we're going to have conversation about this before a motion is made.
That is not what I heard.
He's correct. I'm going to ask for a motion, and in a second, it'll be open for discussion.
Yeah, that's...
Is that the way
that's how those are generally handled, yeah.
So if you would like to discuss anyone today, you can't. That's open for discussion today. But I don't think there's going to be any decision to make if they haven't asked for a motion tomorrow.
Okay. Well, I misunderstood then. Yes, I would like to talk about the three folks. I would like to know how your thoughts on how the interviews went, because I was not able to attend them. I would like to get your thoughts. I know I received a bullet point list from HR stating that their strong points and concerns and things like that. So I just wanted to hear from you how you both looked at this.
I looked at it as Director Rebay sent us three potential candidates to interview for the vendor position. All three are qualified. All three are still, I believe, in high standards with the Pennsylvania Bar Association. That's coming from the director. She actually called and confirmed that. I believe there are two of the candidates right now currently have a conflict of interest with Children and Youth Services. If Rob Alsko and Dana Cletus are contracted with the county as a guardian ad litem, so there's going to be a time where if we hired two of them, they might have to recuse themselves from a case because they'll have a conflict of interest. Joe Ascor with CYS, he does not have a conflict of interest. All three of them are available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week if there's any on-call situations. They said that all three of them have been in front of the either Pennsylvania Superior Court or Pennsylvania Supreme Court. And all three of them have worked under Children and Youth Services. So at this time, I think, you know, we're gonna have to reach out to them and see who would still be interested in the proposal that we're gonna offer tomorrow, because I think we might see one, we could potentially see one of them drop out because the caseload is changing and they're not gonna be able to bill the county for $150,000.
Right. I think that it's important to note that during this process, Dana sent an email to Dan, me, and Tony, and copied Erin about her views on the position. And she states in her email, "I truly think that Dana Quides is the right person for this position. She's passionate about working with children and families and fully understands the mission and vision of the agency. Dana has participated in agency quality services review twice, has been a few in-house committees to address practice and attends agency events, completes extensive research, has been involved in Superior and Supreme Court appeals with cases, and has over 12 years of experience with dependency case. My second choice is for the position would be Rob Alsko. He also has been involved with dependency proceedings for over 12 years and is passionate about his work with children and families. Rob has also been involved with agency initiatives regularly and does extensive legal work on cases. He has been actively involved in the regional AOPC meetings with me and with the judge. Both Donna and Rob come to the agency regularly to meet with caseworkers and consult with staff on specific cases or practices. They both are active on their local Children's Roundtable and have done presentations to the local Bar Association on dependency-related practice for attorneys. I think both are highly respected in the court of Beaver County."
We all received that email.
Right.
That was prior to the interview process. Did Dana, Director Rebe, have any comments after the interview process that you checked on?
Yeah, I did. I gave her a call the day before, and then I was also at the Children's Advisory Board Committee yesterday. She is under, her impression was that by far